I've been seeing articles like these around for a while, where people create these wonderful cavernous maps procedurally using cellular automata, so I thought I'd try creating something similar in Blender. I'm going to show you how I did that, so that you can follow along and make your own. But first, what are cellular automata? A cellular automaton consists of a grid of cells. Each cell can be in one of a number of states, usually just on or off. The state evolves over time based on a set of rules that consider only the cell and its neighbours. Different sets of rules can produce a wide variety of interesting patterns. One of the most well-known examples of a cellular automaton is Conway's Game of Life, but you might have also seen a similar technique used to create Falling Sand-style games. You might even have encountered patterns that formed in a similar way in the wild, such as on the shell of this venomous cone snail. We'll be using a set of rules that produce a pattern that resembles a top-down cave map. So let's get started. Fire up Blender and delete the default cube. Switch to the text editor and add a new script called cellularautomata.py. Let's start off with some imports. We'll need BPY, BMesh, and random. Now we'll define a variable called steps. This will be the number of iterations that our automaton will run for. If you like, you can now set a seed with random.seed. Now we need to get the mesh of the object that we want to run the automaton on. We can get the currently selected object using bpy.context.activeObject. Then we can get the mesh from that object and convert it into a bmesh to make it easier to work with. Now we're going to need a dictionary to hold the state of the cells. We'll consider each vertex of the mesh to be a cell, so they'll all need an entry in the dictionary, storing whether or not they're a wall. To initialize the dictionary, we'll loop through all of the vertices and set each one randomly. Now create a loop that loops once for each of the steps that we defined earlier. Each iteration will create a copy of the wall's dictionary. When we're making changes, we'll make those changes to the copy, and then we'll apply all of those changes at once at the end of the iteration. This means that vertices will effectively be updated simultaneously, and the order we process them in won't matter. Now we can loop through the vertices. For each vertex, we'll want to count the number of neighbours it has. We'll also want to count how many of those neighbours are walls. Now we can change its state based on those counts. If less than half of the neighbours have walls, then remove the wall. If more than half of the neighbours have walls, then place a wall. And if neither are true, then exactly half of the neighbours have walls, and we'll leave it as it is. I found those rules gave me the results I was looking for, but feel free to experiment and see what happens. Once all of the vertices have been iterated over, we can apply the changes we've made so that they can be read by the next iteration. Now that the whole loop is done, the automaton is finished. We just need to add a little more code to get this data into a format we can use. We'll add it to the mesh using an attribute. In case it already exists, we'll first get the attribute. If it doesn't exist, we'll add it. Set its name to wall and its type to boolean. The domain we'll set to point so that it's stored on the vertices. Then we can fill the attribute using the walls dictionary that we just created. Now we'll add some modifiers to the object. We'll first clear the existing modifiers so we don't end up with duplicates. Then we'll add a geometry nodes modifier and set its node group to the node group titled cellular automata. This node group doesn't exist yet, but we'll add it in a bit. Then we'll also add a bevel modifier with four segments to smooth out the sharp edges a little. And finally, we can update the mesh so the modifiers update. Now add a plane, then subdivide it a few times to create a grid. We'll need a couple of materials, one for the ground and one for the walls. You can make these however you want. I used these materials from Ambient CG. For the ground, I brought the value down and then I further darkened the crevices using ambient occlusion. For the walls, I highlighted the edges using an ambient occlusion node with the inside checkbox checked. Add a geometry nodes modifier to the grid and then add a node group to the modifier. Name this group cellular automata. It's important that this name is the same as the name we used in the script to find the node group. We'll start by setting the material for the whole geometry to our ground material. Then we'll subdivide the mesh so that each vertex has a box of faces around it. We can now extrude out the walls. Set the offset scale to the height you want your walls to be and make sure individual is unchecked. We'll need to select which faces to extrude based on our custom attribute. Connect the original unsubdivided geometry to a transfer attribute node. We'll be transferring a Boolean attribute from the nearest point on the geometry. Connect a named attribute node to the attribute input and set its name to wall. It's important that we use the name that we gave the attribute in the script. Now we want to apply the walls materials to the faces at the top or the side of the extruded mesh. We can do this by using a Boolean math node set to OR as the selection for the set material node. Finally, we can output the finished geometry. Now that our node group is done, we can run the script we wrote earlier and we'll see a cave-like pattern appear on the surface of the grid. This is great, but I was really hoping for some larger caverns. You can see that when the automaton runs, the first few steps are spent organizing the initial randomness into something more stable. But once the cells have reached that stable state, extra steps aren't really having an effect. If we introduce some extra randomness into the process, the cells will have to organize themselves into larger caverns to remain stable. Let's add that into our script now. When we are iterating over our vertices, just before we count the number of neighbors, we'll generate a random number, and if that number is higher than our current progress through the steps loop, then we'll set the vertex randomly and skip running our rules on it. This way, we'll reduce the amount of randomness as we go. That's the script finished now. When we run it, we'll get something more cavernous. You can see that the early steps are now much more chaotic, but since we gradually reduce the amount of randomness as we go, the end result is still a clean, cave-like map. And the more steps we instruct the automaton to run for, the larger the caverns will be. At this point, we'll want to set up the render settings. We'll switch the render engine to cycles, and switch the device to GPU. I set my samples all the way down to 16, as I found that this was enough for a still image, but if you're looking to animate yours, then you'll likely want to set this higher to avoid flickering. To speed up the render, we can lower the max light bounces, disable the caustics, and check fast GI approximation, with bounces set to 2. You can light your scene however you like. I lit mine by setting the background color to a dark grey. Then I added a sun lamp with a strength of 6. To soften the shadows, I set its angle up to 20 degrees. I also added a blue point light into the background, and put in a silhouette of a character holding a torch. For the torch light, I used this emission shader. I also added some depth of field focused on the character. Finally, I added some bloom, lens distortion, and a subtle vignette in compositing. The way that we've implemented this is quite general. Using vertices as cells and finding neighbors with edges means that we don't have to just use this on a flat grid. We can use it with any arbitrary mesh. Here's what it looks like on a subdivided icosphere, and here's what it looks like on a donut. If you have any questions, then feel free to post a comment. If you'd like to see the source.blend file, you can find a link to it in the description. I hope you all have a wonderful day. Thanks for watching.